Ham Radio Now from the Shelby Hamfest. And I have a guest here who is going to epitomize and perhaps exaggerate the Boy Scout motto, be prepared. Perhaps be very prepared. Explain to everybody who you are.
My name's Raymond Fosdick, and I'm the editor and owner of Prepped and Prepared, a nationally syndicated magazine. Our first issue hits in January.
All right, so you had come by the booth, and we're looking at my television equipment because you're thinking about doing a TV show to add to the magazine.
We are Prepped and Prepared TV. Its first pilot episode will be coming. We'll be finished filming in the next 30 days.
And so as we were talking about the TV equipment, I started getting interested in the subject matter and thought, well, this might be a pretty good interview. First let's talk about a little bit more about the magazine. You say it is just getting started. The first one's going to come out in January. What kind of stuff is going to be in there?
Our January edition is introducing the magazine to the market. We are the only magazine that is across the board general preparedness. There's several magazines, Mother Earth News being one of them, that definitely get into the same topic matter. However, they're not for the preparedness industry, for the preppers. We cover everything.
I was going to say, when I think of Mother Earth, I think of organic, green. When I think of preppers, and pardon me for saying this, but I think of Guns and Ammo as a closer associate magazine. How far or close to the mark am I?
You're actually very close to the mark. We've actually found a majority of those magazines, such as Guns and Ammo and several of the other firearms magazines, have branched out and created their own kind of doomsday prepper tag-along periodical.
Okay, so they're in that territory. But it sounds like you want to focus laser beam on preparedness and not so much the guns and ammo type stuff.
Most definitely. We are, whether you're preparing for the end of the world or a society ending event, or you're preparing for the next hurricane, next tornado, next, you know, electrical outage that could and probably will occur for one reason or another, this magazine is going to give you the information. We actually cover 5 topics, and we give each topic equal opportunity in the magazine. This is where we differ from the others, from the guns and ammo style or the Mother Earth News style, is we're actually giving, one, let's back up a little bit, every prepper, whether they were call themselves a prepper or not, prepare for the 4 basic things. That is food, shelter, water, and protection. Okay? We actually have added a 5th element, and that's actually what we call it, is the 5th element. And we believe
I believe there's a movie by that name.
There
is.
Has
nothing to do with this, or is it the same thing?
Has nothing to do with it.
Okay.
We do believe that the 5th element, though, is one of the most important elements. And the easiest way to describe it is, you've prepared all this food, you've prepared all this shelter, you've prepared all of this stuff. Did you prepare your marriage?
I'll say that people have not thought about that very much.
Yes.
And let me say one thing here. Before we go too much farther, you are giving me a sales pitch. And on Ham Radio Now, we don't allow sales pitches. So I'm going to dial you back into a conversation, if you don't mind. So let's go to the first 4 elements, and then we'll examine that 5th one in a little bit more detail. Give me the first 4 and then 10, 15 seconds more about each one. What's the deal?
Food. There's obvious
reasons. Because I'm already hungry.
Yeah. Obvious reasons. When electricity shuts down, one of the first things they do is they lock the store doors because they don't want their products walking out.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, now you can't go down to the store to buy the little items.
Yeah, or McDonald's to get a double Big Mac or whatever.
Correct. So food preparation is a big thing of it. Food stores, and this is your freeze-dried food, your ability to garden yourself, to produce some of your fresh foods. All of that falls under the food segment. Water has its own topic. As we all know, you can live for about 72 hours without water.
I can live about like 72 minutes without water. Okay, well, I'll take your word for it. I'm not going to try.
Medically, they will tell you 72 hours, your body then begins the process of dying without water.
Yeah.
Water is a huge, huge part, and fresh water is even a bigger one. we look at the globe as 70% water. Only 30% of that is fresh water, and only about 1% of that is actually potable water.
So what kind of things can you do to get water besides just store jugs, or is that what you do?
Well, a lot of people use store jugs, but we also caution them on that, is water will expire. And it's not that the water itself is going bad, it's what's in the water will make the water undrinkable after periods of time.
And this is tap water or even bottled water from the store, which has got minerals in it because they want it to taste like something. I suppose you could go to distilled water, which is going to be like nothing in it, but who wants to drink that?
It's distilled water is definitely more like nothing, and if you're thirsty, you will love to drink that. But it's not just the water itself. It's the containers that they're in. What are they putting into the water? Was it a perfectly sterile environment when it was bottled? You know, there's a lot of contaminants that can get even distilled water.
So how long do you have? And plastic's probably out. You want metal container, glass?
I would say glass would be one of the better ones, but there's a wide variety of topics on that, and we could spend an entire show just going over.
Yeah, or containers. I imagine several issues of a magazine, so it's going to be in there. Yeah, we're just going to hit the highlights here. So we got food, we got water, and when you want to get the details, subscribe to the magazines coming out in January. What was next?
We have shelter.
Ah, yes, a place to stay. Motel 6 may not be leaving the light on for you.
Your own home may not have the lights on for you. It may become unlivable for whatever reason. We saw it down in Houston in Hurricane Ike. You saw it in New Orleans, Hurricane Katrina. Homes became unlivable. So it's not just a society-ending event. It could also be a weather event that could make you now have to figure out where to live.
Okay, so one little tip on finding a place to live, because once again, you're selling a magazine. We can't tell it all now.
True. One of the things that we actually get in is shelter does not just involve a roof over your head. It is not just a tent. Sometimes shelter is your clothing. The good example of that, they've actually got a TV show out called Naked and Afraid.
I have deliberately avoided that, but I should watch it, I guess.
It actually is one of the few shows out there that I believe is showing a little more realities of it's not as easy to just to run off in the woods and survive as you think.
So that's what that show is all about. It's got a serious component to it, but it's probably still a reality show.
It's got a little bit of reality to it, but it is one of the ones out there that show more of survival is not as easy as it's cut out to be.
Okay. So it's a survival show.
Right. So when it comes to shelter, yes, a house. Yes, a lean-to you build. Yes, all of that is shelter. It keeps you dry. It keeps you warm.
I'm thinking fallout shelter. Over the top?
That's starting to get into the little more extreme sides of things. It's definitely something that preppers are preparing for. And obviously in Oklahoma, they could have used a bunch of them when that tornado hit. So there are reasons to have bunkers, shelters, fallout shelters.
Yeah, fallout shelters is probably not the right name for it anymore. Storm shelter.
Storm shelter. A place you can go that is safe and you're able to keep yourself and your family warm, dry, and living.
You can tell I grew up in the 50s. You're too young for fallout shelter stuff. All right, so we've got food, water, shelter, and number four?
Protection. We have deliberately labeled this
We're not talking condoms here.
No,
we are not. Because that would be number five. Okay.
In a society of ending event, you may not want to have that sort of protection because you want to rebuild society.
Okay. Didn't think that you were going to get that question on this interview. Neither did the audience. Okay, so protection, serious.
Protection is a very serious component. If we look at what happened in Hurricane Sandy, people went desperate within 72 hours. They were dumpster diving. They were taking things, looting. You have to be able to provide protection when our civil authorities are no longer there to do it for us.
Yeah. Now, and just to put the cards on the table, we're talking about not being neighborly. because this is a theme in all kinds of movies and TV shows when there's disasters. They're going to, people, or at least you think people, are going to try to break down the doors to get your stuff because they didn't prepare their own stuff, and you got to keep them out. Now, that may be the extreme. Is there a middle ground here?
When it comes into protection, I don't know if there is a middle ground. We are...
So I'm not that far off base.
No, you're really...
I'm off and off base.
You're referring to movies and TV shows where they've really gone to the, you know, far ends of what could happen. And we're not saying they won't. We're just saying they've gone kind of the far ends of it. But the same holds true no matter what the event that's put you in that situation. If you cannot pick up the phone and call authorities and call your government-appointed officials to help you, then you have to rely on your own. This may be guns. It may be knives. It may be other things.
I was going to say, here we are at guns and ammo now.
So guns and ammo do play a role in it. It's definitely something... Now, do we advocate, you know, having a million rounds of ammunition stored in a fallout shelter and, you know, more guns than you can handle? No. We are recommending more of a conscious effort of, you know, to have protection for your friends and your family that you need to.
The friends you're willing to still call friends.
Well.
The ones that also prepared some of their own stuff.
So let's go into a little not so extreme elements of protection.
Yeah.
Community is actually a form of protection. There's a reason we have neighborhood watches.
Yeah. Now, you've been, imagine watching the show Under the Dome.
Yes.
Big community deal now. I didn't mean to distract you off a topic that you were getting into, so community.
Right. So protection is more than just firearms and knives and ammo. Sometimes it's the community base. And that's one thing that preppers don't have right now is a big community. And they need to think on that because things you can do, I may not be able to do. And the two of us together, all of a sudden, we're fulfilling a bigger segment. You brought up Under the Dome. The one gentleman had the water. One gentleman had the propane, and it became a big conflict.
Yeah, which is, you know, that's the stuff of television shows. And since that's where we all get our general impression of how life is going to be, that's what we think might happen. So what's the reality in
well,
your view?
Well, actually, the scary part of that show is it's a lot like reality because we are trained by TV shows. We are thought that that's what it's going to be.
And you know, so that's where we behave.
The Walking Dead has trained us that we've got to band together in roving marauders. And, you know, if we come across another community, they're more apt to kill us than they are to help us. So that's been implanted, you know, into our minds. And so we've got to think about that. But if we start thinking about it along the community lines, let's go back to Under the Dome. If the guy with the water would have brought the water to the table and said, okay, look, I know I've got the only working well. Gentleman with the propane. Brought that to the table and said, all right, we've got the propane. We can keep people's generators going. We can keep everybody with water. But
and,
no.
And the farmers with food.
Exactly. They created a power base.
Yeah. And but once again, that's to be an intriguing television show. If they'd done things, and I'm thinking you're saying we need to lead our thinking away from us versus them to us together.
Exactly.
Which would be the world's most boring television show, but could keep us alive.
Exactly. It would be a very boring show. However, the reality is, while I'm good at certain things, you're great at certain things, separate. Are you going to be great at running a TV show in the apocalypse, or do you want to live?
Yeah, none of this stuff is going to be working in the apocalypse. Television is going to be the last priority. Communications is a priority, and we'll talk about that because the title of the program still is Ham Radio Now, not Prepper Now. but we'll talk about that in a minute. We've got the community, and we've got some marriage stuff, and then we'll talk radio.
So that definitely leads in. So a form of protection is your community. It's working together to keep yourself fed, watered, safe, and, you know, let's roll this back a little bit. The ultimate idea of being prepared for an event, whether it's a hurricane or a society-ending event, is so that you can return to some semblance of your life afterwards. And that's what we want to help you do.
Yeah. Now, there's a book that I'm thinking of that has that theme, and much longer than a TV show, an old Stephen King novel called The Stand. You're probably pretty familiar with that, too. Rolling his eyes.
Oh, so as we get into, once again, real life would be a pretty boring book.
Yeah.
So The Stand ventures beyond that a little bit.
Well, the Stand goes wacko, but they, I do remember from the, it's been a long time since I read it, but they did find everybody who had their skill and started, at least down the road, of everybody applying their skill to put things back together. The few people that were left and the infrastructure. I guess in that book, the infrastructure wasn't destroyed, just lots and lots of people were. And the infrastructure started falling apart without maintenance, so they went to keep it working.
Correct. In almost every apocalyptic movie you see, what was the one, the 2012 one? Yeah, 2012. That was the name of it, where they put everybody on the boats, and remember, they selected everybody around the world that had the arts and math and sciences.
Yeah, I never saw that one.
Well, it's a general theme across all of the movies is they begin, society has a tendency, the ones in power, of wanting to grab everybody that they think they're going to need for their skills. In essence, when it rolls back on the layman, we need to think of that with a strong community base that's strong protection in itself, because you've got more than one, but you've also now got skill sets that you didn't have. You can't be 100% great at everything.
Yeah. So in the immortal, immemorable, I think I just made that word up, words of Hillary Clinton, it takes a village.
Yes.
you may or may not want to ally yourself with Hillary Clinton's words. I don't know, and I don't really care. But in this case, that's sort of the concept.
Yes. There is some level of you want to have skill sets. You want to have that village. You want to have that community. And you know, to branch it in kind of into the ham radio side, ham radio is a huge community, and it's one that
and
spans.
And a skill set.
And a skill set, and it spans the globe. It has that capabilities. So the same community that gets built throughout the ham community, you need to think of on, you know, a survival aspect also.
Okay. So we'll do that, but we need to do marriage first. But I've got two-sided coin here to ask still about community, and that is leadership and whatever semblance of government is left. And the prepper movement, in addition to worrying about tornadoes and hurricanes and floods and all that stuff, there is an element of it that is the government's going to get us, and we got to prepare ourselves for that apocalyptic day. And I was asking, as we were talking before we started doing a show, is there much of a wacko movement? And I guess I would put that into the wacko movement side of things. Now I'll stop talking and let you comment.
Well, yes and no. Remember, the Boston Tea Party was a wacko movement.
Okay, fair
so,
enough.
And we're all thankful that it happened.
Yeah.
There's been what's classified as wacko movements and wackos. All of them signed our Constitution.
They were, yeah, we celebrate our revolutionary heritage to the point of saying it was a good idea for us then. It's not a good idea for almost anybody else, and especially nobody here now.
And I say yes and no to that. As we've no doubt seen coming out with a lot of the leaks and the NSA, what they're all involved in, there's some stuff that our government is doing that's like, tisk, tisk. You know, it reminds us of the revolutionary side. Now, you are correct. There is an element of our society that is the whole revolutionary. Is this something that we're promoting or we believe in? No, not at all. It exists.
And we're addressing some of those people right now. They are going to be watching, and they may or may not recognize that in themselves. And they may proudly wear that label.
There are a few. We are trying to not promote it. Yeah, my personal beliefs, and this isn't necessarily one that's brought up in the magazine because we try to stay very unpolitical,
okay,
is our government does need a reset button. Do we need to fall in the ways of what's happened in Egypt and Syria and, you know, a lot of the Middle East? No, I don't want to go back to the Stone Age.
Yeah. So the reset button that we push just about every November is not quite powerful enough?
No, it's really not. One of the best ideas I've ever seen is if we want to fix Congress and fix our government, make it so they can't write a bill that's over 10 pages long and it has to be in regular English.
Yeah.
And if there's something in there that doesn't apply to the title, it doesn't belong in the bill.
The geniuses that put together the Constitution missed that one, I guess.
Yes, they did. So there are a few things in the government. Back to the magazine and the wacko side, they're... I won't refer to them as wackos. I refer to them as they're very strong believers in this is what's going to affect them. And I actually have an editorial that I've written for our January issue, and it's called Chasing the Conspiracy. Because even though we try to remain very neutral, even though we try to remain unpolitical, even though we try to do these things, I've sat in our newsroom and gotten a call of, there's two battalions of British troops on the ground in the U.S. right now for training. And it's like, ooh, this is interesting.
If the British are coming.
All of a sudden, you're
Was it one lamp or two?
All of a sudden, you're going down this rabbit hole chasing this conspiracy because you can look at what's happening in our current times and apply it to it. And, oh, my word, it's true, it's true. The reality is you've just fallen into that whole conspiracy theorist, what some people call wackos. You really haven't. You've gotten caught up in it. We need to back up. We need to look at the big picture. It's going to be a combination of a lot of different things that cause the cataclysmic society-ending events. So that's one of the things. We don't look at anybody as their way out there. Heck, they might be the ones that come true. Remember, back in the, in the 1700s, they were way out there thinking they were going up against the British.
I believe the phrase is, you never expect the Spanish Inquisition.
Exactly.
And I'm not sure exactly what that means, but I've heard it somewhere before. So the editorial stand on the magazine is, this is one of the things to be aware of, but you're not. It's not going to be your primary focus.
No. Once again, we really try to stay out of politics. We try to not even surf the lines of left or right. Now, because we do are a little bit more pro-gun, we do lean to the right, but not intentionally.
Do you deliberately cover both bases or all bases with maybe a focus one direction or another, or is there something you're going to say, no, we're not going to go that way ever at all, no way?
It's, I don't know, I guess because of my upbringing, and since I am the controlling interest of the magazine, I will see myself leaning a little towards the right on most stories. I do my best, and I have an editorial staff to help pull back, but they are all under the orders for me of our readers have to be well-informed. And the end of their stories, whatever it may be, whether it's food, water, shelter, protection, or the fifth element, needs to leave the reader with the ability to answer their own questions. We're not there to dictate what you should or shouldn't do. We want to present you with good information and allow you to make your own decisions.
Okay. So let's move on to the fifth element, leave something for the magazine on the first four, and that is your marriage. Which, not everybody's going to be married, but most people are in relationships of some kind or other.
The fifth element is more than marriage. Marriage, the story topic of did you prepare your marriage, just kind of gives you a general understanding of what the fifth element is. Is did you prepare your kids' mental state for this environment?
So it's actually family more than marriage.
It's family. It's actually a lot more mental. Our first cover, as you can see here, is a very scary image. It's one that we've got actually blown up big on a poster board, so when we're out at events, people see it, and we've heard it more than once. This scares me.
Now, this is from your website, prepared.com. Preppedandprepared.com. Prepared having one P in the middle, not the two that I initially stuck into the into the browser when I was trying to find it. So, and once again, that's the website. So, and that's a look at the what the first cover issue is going to look like.
That's the very first cover of the magazine. And, you know, when you look at that magazine, it really screams a lot of different things. And we've run into a lot of the preppers who can't get beyond their bug out bags in their first 10 days. And this kind of shows off a lot of that. He did something right. He survived. But yeah, in what state?
Let's see what some of the stuff says here. I wasn't even looking at the details. Food. Good. Things that go boom. The best way. What are things that go boom?
That has a lot to do with your protection. Firearms and
okay.
of that
sort.
That's
what I thought. But
This is more about how the best ways to make them last.
And not shoot up all your ammo.
Not shoot up all your ammo, but also how to keep them clean, how to keep them protected.
Yep.
They can't protect you if they're in disarray.
Yeah, and that's probably I'm not a gun person at all. I'm not an anti-gun person. I just, you know, they're not something I've learned very much about. I have learned I'm a pretty good shot though. Friend of mine, one of the other folks that does the show with me, Jeff Wittick, AC4ZO, is a gun enthusiast. Gun enthusiast, and has an armory, and takes immaculate care of all that stuff. So he took me shooting one day and fired a few handguns, and it turns out I hit the target pretty well. But it's not my big deal. So someone like me, if I were to buy a gun and shoot it once in a while, I probably would just stick it back in the box when I'm done. Bad idea.
Bad idea. You need to clean it. You need to make sure that when you pull it out of the box, the elements haven't gotten to it and made it rusted it or, you know, wide variety of things. Remember, the ultimate ability of a firearm to protect yourself is that you know when you pull it out and have to use it, the first time you pull that trigger, it's going to work. The worst thing in the world is to go click.
Click. Yeah, and there's a bullet in there, but it ain't going anywhere.
It's not going where you want it, which means now the other person knows you're effectively unarmed.
Yeah, and he also knows your intentions.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're watching Guns and Ammo today here on Ham Radio Now. Well, I guess I got there because we were looking at the magazine here. Your choices, were they the correct ones on page 32? Is it going to be on page 32, or is that just... For working purposes.
Odds are really good it's going to be on page 32.
Okay. So, your choices, were they the correct ones? So what kind of choices?
So this actually kind of leads into our Prepped and Prepared TV also.
Okay. Well, we haven't really finished the family part, so maybe I better let you get back to that. As you notice, I tend to wander around. No, I don't tend to wander around. I tend to dart back and forth willy-nilly. So back to family.
So the fifth element is covering more than just family. It's covering your mental status. It's covering all of the things that you probably weren't thinking about when you were preparing. You know, how do you get from a disaster, a society-ending event, back to some semblance of your way of life before? And that's what the fifth element really encompasses. One of the best things is I actually have one of our journalists, he leads a school, and one of the videos he shows goes over how to treat your wife. And he shows a video of a husband hollering and screaming at his wife and just being real abusive.
In other words, ordinary life. for some people.
For some. But he said, is this really the smart way to be?
Yeah. Now, do you think that a disaster scenario would lead people into doing that who wouldn't normally be doing that?
Yes. There are very calm and deliberate people out there. However, we've all seen what stress can do to a calm and deliberate person. It can make them very irrational. It can make them very stress and fear both ruin good people.
Yeah. Well, and in all the disaster movies, there are the hysterical people.
Right.
And that may not be exactly who you're talking about, but there may be a question of what do you do with the hysterical people?
Yes. That's a whole other element. In this video,
that's your state of mind, though.
Correct. In this video, they show him hollering, being abusive to her. Then they show a society-ending event 6 months later remember, there's no law enforcement, there's no laws, there's murder is no longer illegal, you know, type deal. And they are walking down the road, and where is the wife in this scenario? She's 6 to 8 feet behind him, and he starts verbally abusing her again. Guess what she does?
I'm guessing she pulls out a gun and blows him away.
Pretty much. And it shows there of he was obviously not prepared. The marriage wasn't prepared ahead of time, much less after a stressful event of that nature.
Yeah. Where is that video on the internet for everybody to see? Or
I'm not sure. Our journalist owns Black Dog Survival School, and that's okay, one that so he uses.
All right. BlackDogSurvivalSchool.com. All right, so check that out. Anything else about family, state of mind, fifth element?
The fifth element, we actually believe in the magazine that that is the most important element. You can have all the food, water, shelter, protection in the world, but if your state of mind and that fifth element is not taken care of, it's useless.
So what kind of things can you do? You know, the short list, because we don't want to steal too much from the magazine.
One of it is thinking along the lines of that community. You've got to really get a good grasp of, are you going to be one of those people that power corrupts absolutely? And if you are, then you might want to think of ways that, how will you be able to tone that down to work with others? Are you an abusive type of person? How will you tone that down? How can you begin working on that now? Unfortunate side of a lot of these things is most people that are in those scenarios don't see it in themselves. They cannot see that they're an abusive person. They, you know, they just don't see it as abuse.
Yeah.
They see it as regular life.
So what I'm thinking is this is a call to a certain amount of leadership. If the government that we had has ceased to function, on whatever local geographic level that you do establish community, you probably need leadership again.
There is going to be a level of leadership, yes. Is, well, I make a comment on what the right type of leadership is? No.
I mean, that sounds like a really important thing to get right.
It's a very important thing to get right. It's a life and death thing to get right. However, it's also one of those that absolute power corrupts absolutely. And it's one you've got to surf. You know, we almost go, we need that utopian society, but we also know that humans in general aren't capable of it.
Well, yeah, every utopian society movie has ended up as a disaster movie about in the second act sometimes. So, yeah, we know that doesn't work. And hopefully the magazine will have a long, healthy life because no disasters have wiped out the existence of it. And humans are pretty much never going to abandon the thought, at least, that there's a need for it. So you got a while to start thinking about these things. We'll add that concept in. Maybe I'll write you an article.
Maybe. And, you know, it's, once again, just like in the ham community, there's a community and there's people all over. Preparedness needs to be the same way. Bad thing is most preppers are very secretive. Most preppers are very antisocial and they're trying to keep their stashes hidden and off the radar and because they don't want people coming and taking them.
So are you trying to pull those people back into more a zone of society or to reach those people that are the best they can do in a disaster is hope McDonald's is still open and convince them they need to do a little bit more? Or maybe, you know, they're not mutually exclusive. You could do both.
No, what we're trying to do is show them, especially through the fifth element, that there is more that they're going to need than just their food, water, shelter, and protection. That there's other elements of it. Remember, it's returning back to a way of life that you had before. You're not going to get it back the way it was, but to get back to where it's comfortable and you can live a good life.
Yeah, well, and that depends on the scope of the catastrophe. Hurricane is going to be a catastrophe for a limited geographic area for a limited time, not limited as much as we might like. And for some people, it is years, if not decades. But for most, it's going to be a few months to a year or so. And they've either moved or their house is rebuilt or something, and the water's gone, and they've cleaned up, and they're back. And the government didn't stop. So they needed that. They needed their preparation planning for the initial few weeks until the resources came in from outside again.
Correct.
The big catastrophes, you know, they're the ones that will get everybody all excited, but they're probably not the ones that are going to happen all that often.
Correct. Well, we hope not.
We hope. When that happens, we'll stop publishing the magazine and the TV show.
Right.
All right. So what I'm getting out of the fifth element is you got to stay sane.
Very much so.
If you go nuts, you got no hope of anything else working for you.
Well, think of it this way. You've heard an individual go, "I saw red and just didn't know what I did." If you saw red and didn't know what you did, you are a liability, not just to yourself, but to your loved ones. So the fifth element is going to be delving into how to train yourself for this super stressful, super scary, very, you know, hard time, and to get through it in a livable fashion so that you can continue life.
And you're not likely to do that just by sitting there meditating all by yourself. Like you're saying, you need to talk to people. You need to have people in your life, your family, friends, community, and everybody, talk it out.
Most definitely. You know, some of our biggest problems in history could have probably been solved not with a gun, but with talking it out. And however, there's been some of them that just, you know, it's, I don't know.
You're sounding a little bit lefty to me right now.
I get into the arenas, both sides, and unfortunately, with the magazine, I've got to stay neutral on it.
Yeah. Well, you're saying that you are going to lean right, not run right.
Right.
You're not trying to win a Republican primary. You're trying to stay alive.
Exactly. I'm not just trying to stay alive. This guy stayed alive. But
this guy here
on the cover of the magazine
doesn't look like he's having a good time.
No.
What is that on the bottom there?
It's a torn up baby doll.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Yikes.
My point here is, if this is what I get to survive to, I would have rather gone out in the Big Bang. I don't want that's not a quality of life. Yes, survive, but return to where you've got a decent quality of life.
Okay. And the overarching point is, we can't do it by ourselves. We will need to work together.
We will need to work together because you cannot do everything. You can do a lot. An individual can do a lot, but that individual cannot do everything.
All right. So the audience is now saying, when are we going to talk about ham radio? Because we're here at a ham fest, and you are not a ham.
No, I'm not.
Have you ever had an interest in ham radio? You have an awareness.
I have an awareness of it, but not because of ham radio. I have an interest in it because of what we refer to as SSB, single sideband, for our boat.
Okay. On the open ocean?
Correct.
HF sideband, which is used by, I guess, required by any vessel that is going more than a certain distance off of shore.
It's not required. However, it's real smart to have it. There's a lot of frequencies, weather nets and everything that you can tap into. Weather facts used to come through it. Now with some new technology, you don't have to rely on weather facts as much anymore. But you can tune into, you know, one of them is Chris Parker Weather Radio down up for the Caribbean. And he goes over weather patterns that are occurring.
Now, so, is that a shortwave station, broadcast station, or is that a ham?
That is shortwave.
Okay.
So now with our SSBs, we do broach into some of the frequencies used by ham.
Yeah, and hams will start saying, well, you got to have a license. Emergency communication is a different thing, and we've heard on our maritime mobile net in the frequency 14.300, it's probably a very familiar one to you, boats will come up not all the time, but with you know, a couple times a year, not a ham, but in trouble,
mm-hmm.
knowing that's a place to go. And I'm going to guess that you know a lot of other sailors who have ham equipment, who have become hams, because it adds an element of both safety and entertainment, interest to your voyage.
Most definitely. And another place that a lot of sailors will get into the ham realms is so that they can tap into the VOIP structures and make phone calls out and data out in and out from their shortwave systems they have on board.
Okay. So adding ham radio to the preparation, what do you call the movement? Are you happy with the word prepper? Or is that a label that's just got too much pejorative in it?
It's a label that, unfortunately, is getting tied to a lot of extremists.
Yeah.
And that's what we need to watch out for.
So what do you want to call it?
I don't know if there's a better term for it. Because when we say we're a general preparedness magazine, people frown at us and look, and they really not comprehend. And it requires us to go, have you seen Doomsday Preppers? We're just not that extreme.
Okay.
So.
And it is prepped and prepared. So,
correct.
So you got to have that word in there somewhere. So we'll stick with it and hope that it doesn't get totally absorbed by the sixth element. All right. So where were we going here? I forgot.
With the ham. How does all this tie into ham?
Yeah.
So getting into... main place that I guess in a society ending event, I'm not exactly sure how ham equipment is shored up against EMP.
The theory is not very well. If that's the event, because all of our equipment these days is solid state, and the old stuff, the tube stuff, which a lot of hams still have, and much of it in working condition, but by far not the majority. Very, very small minority of hams have working tube-type equipment as a complete station, would not rely on anything solid state. I'm told that stuff would survive. And there are varying opinions on how much solid state stuff would survive. I don't know.
Correct. Now, the only thing I have to go off of is in the middle 1800s, I'm not sure the exact year, there was a solar flare that produced an EMP. And all of the telegraph stations, which had very minimal electronics to them, most of them burn up. It took down the telegraph grid that existed at the time. So Eileen of ham and communication, what are you doing for it? So there are levels of things you can do. However, depending on the solar flare, depending on the EMP, how close proximity of its actual impact you are, it still may not survive. A lot of people are carrying and putting equipment into electrostat devices and bags and all of that and putting those aside so that if their primaries burn up because of an EMP, they've got that aside and it should have been protected.
Yeah. And there are plenty of other technical issues depending on the nature of whatever the catastrophe is. How long do power sources last? Ham radio is nowhere without a power source of some kind. Well, solar will last forever, as long as the solar cells keep working. But that's about the, and wind, I suppose, although generators need maintenance. So, you know, beyond those, the power sources go away after a while.
Well, there's actually, here in America, there's two power grids. One of them is protected against EMP. It's completely shielded, all of its lines and
really?
Everything.
Never heard of that.
It's called a safety corridor, and it runs from... there's a segment of Arkansas up through Tennessee into Kentucky and over. It's a long swath, basically. And I don't have the details on it, but there's several people out there that do. Then there's another one that has the ability that if the national grid goes down, that it is still not digital. A lot of our electrical grid is actually a digital grid now, and how it handles and switches and everything. This one is still the old style, and while it's shut down, it can be brought back up. Everything's still in functional order.
That's not a conspiracy theory. That's a we know it, that's out there. Is it admitted, or is it, well, we know it's there, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, but we can't tell you?
Do I have absolute proof sitting on my desk? No. Will I ever have it? It's not something that I'm going to go after. It is something that I'm more apt to go, okay, if it exists, great. That means somewhere there'll be power. Somewhere we'll be able to charge batteries. Somewhere we'll, you know, have some semblance of life. And from that, we can grow it back into a bigger grid.
Yeah, because the likelihood of that system reaching my wall plug, I guess, would be pretty small.
Correct. Now, what can help out? A lot of people don't think beyond what they've already got. So let's now relate, how can a ham operator prepare to go beyond a society-ending event where there is no longer an electrical grid, where there's no longer, you know, any of that going on? Stuff still works, but what can he do? Have you ever looked into fuel cells?
Well, I know about them.
Most people know about them. They're actually relatively easy to build. They're real easy to maintain. They don't provide a lot of amperage, but they provide power. And there's other ways that you can store up to get amperage. These are some of the things that, as a ham, they could begin to educate themselves on. Of alternative, buildable, out of raw materials, power sources.
Okay. Well, of course, we're not, those things are important to everybody, not just hams. But hams may be in the group of people that are more technologically competent than the average member of the population. Although we are a wide variety, many of us not very technical, many of us very, very technical, many of them so specialized that their technology advantage won't be very useful. But in terms of people that are more likely to be able to do this than the general population, yeah, I'd say hams could be interested in this, especially if they've got the motivation of getting their radio still working.
Correct. And, you know, a lot of hams provide some great public service in disaster scenarios of providing communication across into open communication areas. So they're able to get, you know, from the disaster zone communication in and out real easily.
Yeah.
So they're already doing that. So if hams can bring their equipment back up quicker or faster, they're going to help out the broader community a lot better that way.
Yep. Now, so, hams like to think they're the only ones who can do that. But you were bringing up your example of your marine communications. You know, there's boats all over the place that have HF, worldwide and regional communications, military companies that use it that we're not very familiar with. So we're not the only ones. But, you know, maybe we may be a little more distributed, especially inside small communities.
Correct. But that's where I see hams delving into the preparedness scene, is how can they prepare their equipment for any sort of thing to happen, and how can they secure their power sources? And it's a matter of taking raw materials, you know, digging copper out of the ground, raw materials. How can you do that to bring this equipment back online? And that's, if I was a ham and I was beginning the prep side, forget about the food and water and all that, that's easy to do. You know, anybody can do that.
Relatively.
Relatively.
Not that everybody's going to do it.
No, they're not. So what can the ham guys begin researching? What can they begin publishing? What can they begin working towards to bring that, you know, their equipment back online?
Yep. Will there be a communications focus to part of the magazine? Will it be just a very occasional article, or will it be something routine?
We do not have a specialist on staff that is communications specialist, and it is not one of the five elements. It actually exists in two of the elements, which one is shelter and one is protection. Mm-hmm. So that's where it'll kind of go back and forth. It does exist in the fifth element also, because it's a mentality. It's that community. It's,
yeah,
you know,
it's a way to not feel totally alone. Isolated and alone. even if where you happen to have survived is cut off from just about everybody else, if you can talk to them. One of the scenarios in a lot of the disaster movies is, are we the only ones left?
I am legend.
Yeah, they all go looking for the ham, and the ham turns out to be some wacko.
But I Am Legend is a great example of that.
That's a Will Smith, I think.
Correct.
Yeah. Not sure I saw that. I might have.
2012, they...
Jericho, they looked for the ham, but they, you know, they kind of wondered.
Well, this is interesting. In 2012, Woody Harrelson played the wacky guy who had a ham radio show, and they went looking for him because he had all the conspiracy theory.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
so
that's who we are, folks. We're the wackos.
No, there's actually a lot of good hams out there that, you know, there are good people, and they have the community in mind. They have.
Yeah. Keep telling yourself that.
Not saying all of them, but we meet everybody from all walks of life, and we ultimately, part of the fifth element is we do try to see the good in people. Right. That's ultimately what's going to make it better in the long run.
Okay, so the magazine is coming around in January, and it will be just a dead tree paper magazine, or online, or some of both, or where, you know,
we actually publish in three different media types, and most people don't realize there's three now.
I'm thinking there's online and there's pulp. What's number three?
One that's actually termed digital, because we've gone from just our paper magazine or print.
Yeah, show it to the one of those cameras. Yeah, there we go.
This is our February cover, by the way. Print magazines, there are a lot of preparedness people that, like I said, are very shy, withdrawn, don't want to be around,
they won't be online.
They don't want to be linked to computers because the government's watching them, you know.
Well, they're right.
And they're listening now.
Government doesn't care, but they are watching.
You know who I am. No. Anyway, so we provide them with the print. There's also a lot of people who don't want these magazines coming to their house. So with the new tablets and everything, this is now a digital publishing arena. Okay, and I know you're going, what's the difference between digital and online?
I am.
It's actually two different ways of presenting the material. Our digital platforms, the tablets and everything, is still like reading a regular magazine. You still flip the pages. And
okay, I got that. Yeah, and that's So you can see web pages, which are laid out like web pages, or you can see a variety of publications. And most of the ham publications that are going online are doing it that way. They emulate the magazine, maybe with some enhancements in terms of links and video and stuff that's embedded that you can't do in print.
Correct.
But they still look more like a magazine, which, because I'm old and traditional, that's the way I prefer to see things.
And that's why Prepped and Prepared is we provide the information every way we can. There's a wide variety of people. Me personally, I like the digital aspect on my iPad. And the reason why is because now I can carry 100 magazines with me and read any one that I want. And it weighs, you know, my little 3-pound tablet that I carry. Whereas if you're carrying your print issues around, you might have two or three in your backpack, but that's it. So that's why we want to publish the magazine.
As long as your batteries are holding out in the iPad, or you got the fuel cell to charge it up with, and it keeps working, because a magazine, if you take care of it, will last for years and years and years, and an iPad just never will.
Well, my iPad did survive a plane crash.
Wow, you were in a plane crash?
Last September.
Which one?
I was a private aircraft.
Oops. Okay. Where did that happen? Tell me a little bit about it. Suddenly, we've riveted the audience.
we had a fire in the cockpit. We came out of 11,000 feet, hit the Gulf of Mexico at 100 knots.
Ow.
Yeah, we were about 45 nautical miles southeast of Louisiana.
I'm a pilot. What kind of plane are we talking about?
It was a twin-engine Baron C-55 series.
Okay, so kind of big. Kind of big.
Decent plane.
Kind of big for a small plane.
Correct.
It's not a Piper... The ubiquitous Piper Cub. Are you a pilot?
Yes, I was co-pilot that day.
Okay. So what engine failure? What went wrong?
There's a fire in the cockpit. We think it was the heater. So it's in 3,000 feet of water. We'll never know.
Fire in a cockpit, I guess it must have been a severe one to Because you know, a little fire or something like that, well, you can just declare an emergency and go land somewhere.
We were, if you know anything about your IFR charts, you can find the Redfin intersection over the Gulf of Mexico just south of Louisiana. And that's where we went down. We were just getting ready to lose contact with Houston Center. And
okay, so that may be like 1,500 miles offshore.
No, well, we were going over the segment from there to Sarasota, Florida. So we were getting ready to head into that no man's land.
Yeah.
There's a small one. Unless you're at high altitude, there's a small no man's land that exists out there.
Okay, so you're in the water. How did you get back to shore?
Coast Guard helicopter showed up about 3 hours later.
Okay, so your ELT went off, hit the satellite, let everybody know, or did you get a radio call through first?
No, first option on fire in the cockpit, first thing on your checklist is master off. And that's exactly what we
did. Turns off the radio.
Exactly. my buddy was halfway through the call to Houston Center of, Houston, we have, and that's when I keyed the switch.
Yeah, that's why hams learned to say the word, well, they argue about what word to say. Mayday, SOS, emergency, that's the first word.
Yeah.
but if they don't get any more than that, if they don't know who you are or where you are, that's not going to help very much. They'll just go into a tizzy and say, there's somebody in trouble. Who is it?
And so they never got a ping off of our ELT, not a single one. And
so how did they know anything about you being there? Well, I guess you disappeared from radar.
Well, we were on an IFR flight plan. We did go off radar. But we had one of those little spot connects.
Okay. Yeah, I've heard about those. In fact, they use those in some of the super high altitude ballooning things. Mm-hmm. They put ham radio APRS and stuff on those, but they've started putting some of the spot connects on because the balloon sometimes goes out of range of any APRS system, especially if it's going over the ocean. So
right,
they can find out where it is. So that's sort of a backup ELT.
It's what saved our lives that day. Well, one of the things. We had our lives in jeopardy multiple times throughout that entire event.
Yeah. So you were going over open water. You were flotation prepared?
If you call those little yellow life jackets flotation prepared, yes.
Well, they kept you from having to tread water anyway, too hard.
Yeah. I couldn't even fathom that. I would have given anything for a life raft, but no, I couldn't fathom having to tread water for 3 hours.
So how did your iPad survive that? And what wasn't the first thing you grabbed?
So everybody asks, is like, why did you grab an iPad? So in cockpits now, your tablets are becoming EFBs, your electronic flight books. So me and my buddy both have one sitting in our lap almost the entire flight, anytime we're flying. After the incident, we hit the water. By the time I was able to sit up in my seat, pop the seatbelt off, water was up to my butt. And actually, we were on the Today Show, and you can look it up, iPad plane crash, and it'll pop up.
We just had a plane crash in the Gulf of Mexico.
I'm talking to a celebrity, everyone. I didn't even know that. Well, I guess from the magazine, you're going to be a celebrity in your community. But here's Big Time TV, and you're on my little show. I'm honored and flattered and stuff.
But anyway, so
did they make you stop doing a sales pitch on Today's show?
No. Anyway,
did they talk about the magazine, or did they just want to know the plane crash?
It was all about the plane crash.
Yeah. Did you get any magazine stuff in at all?
No.
No prepper stuff?
Nope. Anyway.
Missed opportunity.
So my buddy jumps out of the plane. As I'm getting out, I look down and I see the iPad sitting there, and it's in a waterproof case. And I'm like, and I grabbed it. Because, once again, we could tell where we were at. Nobody else could see from that, but we could tell. And, you know, it was just one of those things of comforting things to have along with us.
Yeah, plus you could watch some videos while you're waiting.
We made one.
Really?
Yeah.
Is that visible anyplace? Did you put that online?
If you Google iPad plane crash, it will come up. The Today Show segment, they show the whole video.
Okay. Okay, so we were getting into this because we were talking about the way the magazine was going to be on the iPad, and I was saying they're not going to last. Proving me wrong. But tell me a little bit about the structure of the magazine. You didn't think about doing this 2 weeks ago.
No, this has been something that has, it's needed. It's currently, there's a few magazines covering some of the topics, but there's not one dedicated to the preparedness, to being a prepper. And that's what we want to do. So the structure of the magazine, we give equal opportunity to the five elements. And that is one of the most important aspects. The magazine, we are trying to keep it so that our advertising does not eliminate content. We are trying to keep our content as much as possible with the magazine.
I'm not sure exactly what that means.
So a lot of your magazines, if you've gone out there and you flip through them, have you felt like there's more ads than there is story?
Well, when I read Cosmo, yeah.
Well, a lot of magazines. Actually, Popular Mechanics, you know, a lot of magazines you're thinking of, Time, Newsweek, all of those.
Yeah, poor Time and Newsweek have kind of lost all their advertising because Newsweek has gone off of the paper market.
Correct.
But yeah, okay, I know what you're talking about. It's advertising is the reason for being there, and the articles are just kind of filler.
Correct. So those magazines have 70 to 80% advertising with 20 to 30% content. We're trying to keep our magazine at 50%, 50%. That way you're still getting educational content every magazine, yet we can keep printing it from our advertisers.
Okay. What kind of, I keep forgetting I need to switch the right picture here. What kind of staff have you got? How big is this operation?
It started off small, and the magazine has quickly grown beyond us, beyond our first
and
office.
That's without even been published yet.
Correct. We have writers from all walks of life all over the United States providing content. They specialize in certain areas. We have a photographer on staff. We now have video personnel on staff that will be providing content for our TV show. The magazine as a whole is being formalized, and it grows on a regular daily basis. And it's exciting, it's fast-paced, and it's a little scary all in the same time.
Starting any business, especially one that's serious, is scary. Where are you based? And these days, it doesn't have to be in one place, I guess.
No, it doesn't. While our headquarters is in Fort Mill, South Carolina, which is very close to Charlotte, North Carolina, we...
Charlotte wants you to say Charlotte, USA.
Yeah.
They want to disown North Carolina, or at least they want to put on some airs. But anyway, we know where you are.
They don't even have a downtown. They try to call it uptown. I don't know what all that's about.
Okay, we've made an enemy of everybody in Charlotte. All right, so you're in Fort Mill.
We're in Fort Mill, South Carolina, and that's where we're headquartered at. But like I said,
Is it in your basement?
No.
Be honest with me. Is it in your basement? Is it in your mom's house?
No, it is actually in our corporate headquarters office. And we actually, I use that line on advertisers. I'm like, this wasn't dreamt up in a basement, some guy eating Cheetos, watching TV, going, I think I'll start a magazine. You know? No, this is actually coming from myself and my teams and everything with a strong corporate background. And now we're rolling into the magazine, the media industry.
Yeah, I was going to ask you what you've done before. Where does your expertise come from? Where can we look up your history besides on Facebook?
I try to keep my personal life out of the limelight.
Well, your business history. My
business history. Actually, one of the banners, DIY Watermakers, is a company that's owned by our corporate. If you go to raggedsphere.com, which is actually our corporate website, you'll see there's about 8 different companies underneath it.
Okay, raggedsphere, S-P-H-E-R-E?
Yep.
Okay, .com. Okay, I'll check that in editing as well and stick that up. I'm doing good to be able to just have this one image up here on this, yeah, on this monitor.
So
you've been in media and publishing and in a variety of enterprises?
I've been involved in lots of different businesses over the years. I owned a computer company at one point in time. We had 14 employees in the U.S. and 6 in Mexico. I've delved into international business quite a bit. So this wasn't created by, you know, somebody sitting in their mother's basement type deal. It was a magazine created out of a void in a market that was recognized as a business potential. and formalized. Now, it isn't an industry that the company and myself haven't had as much experience in, magazine publishing, but...
Yeah, watch out. Your bracelet is banging the mic thing. There you go.
But we have a strong business background to back it up.
Okay.
And that is where the power of the magazine is really going to come from. Our content is provided from specialists in their individual fields from around the U.S.
Now, how did you go find those people?
Through a network of contacts. And now that the magazine's much more formalized and people are hearing about us, and we've actually got specialists coming out of the woodwork. But we've already began working. Like, our February issue has Joe Tedai, the co-star of Dual Survival.
That's on the guy
here.
Joe Tedai. The star of what?
He's the co-star of Discovery Channel's Dual Survival.
Okay. Discovery Channel's getting, it used to be sort of like a PBS, and now it's like a MTV. The MTV of the documentary and...
Being in the media industry now, I'm understanding of why it does...
Oh, they want an audience. They want to make money.
They want to make money. That kind of gets into our show. Is I have opted... It's got two segments to it. One is where we actually force a prepper to prepare for to live their scenario for 72 hours. So, nuclear fallout. We go in, we shut off their power, we shut off their water, we shut everything down. They've got to live for the next 72 hours. Did they prepare for it properly? And we do an analysis of before and after and find out, you know, what they could have done to make it better.
Yeah. Is this going to, where are you going to try to put this? Is it going to be internet, or are you going to try to get it on real TV?
It is going to be, in the beginning, fed through our servers and through our applications and everything that
we
write.
By the way, Leo Laporte just got mad at me because he says the internet is real TV and we're going to take over, and I believe him.
However, more than likely it will be pitched to networks. Will one pick it up? We don't know. The other segment of the TV show...
That's going to be that level of production. It's
correct.
Professional production.
Yes.
You don't want that camera.
I don't know much about cameras. That's why I was asking. It's honestly, there's a team that they'll be involved in all that. I'll just have to write checks.
Yeah.
But I also try to prepare myself for what they do tell me. And I want to have a little knowledge and a little idea. I'm not just one of those that relies completely on everybody.
All right. So how, in terms of the television, the magazine would be a monthly?
Magazine is published monthly. There's 12 issues a year.
And the television program, how often do you think you want to try to get that out? Is that going to be more of an experiment, or are you committed to it?
We are going to produce 13 episodes.
Okay, that's like a full series of a real...
It'll be a series.
TV.
How often it will be published, if it's just us producing it and us, you know, putting it online and everything, it'll either be a weekly or a monthly type thing. And that way we're, you know, providing content from it over time, not just throwing it all out there at once.
Television is time-consuming and resource-consuming to produce. Magazines aren't easy, but television is hard.
Magazines are expensive to produce, and most people don't understand how expensive. They also take about 3 months to do a single issue. So... It takes 3 years to produce a year's worth of content. Think of it that way.
Yeah. I mean, you got to divide it among a big team to get stuff out every month.
TV is even more expensive and time consuming. And even with small rigs, it's very expensive, very time consuming. However, our gear review segment of the TV is the fun one. And that's where we're kind of getting into how you get your audiences. We're kind of do it in Mythbuster style, where something will blow up every time.
You know? See if it's going to work.
Exactly.
Yep. That's the whole idea, is it's got to be fail safe.
It's got to survive.
Well, here's a TV tip. Talking head talk shows are relatively cheap and fast to produce. Stuff where you've got to actually show somebody doing something from multiple camera angles and you put things together, that takes a long time. The reality shows are somewhere in the middle, but they're still production intensive. Survivor, the king of the reality shows, will take a air conditioned trailer or multiple air conditioned trailers full of editing equipment and the editors and stuff. So you've got these folks in the jungle, and a quarter mile away is Hollywood, full up, no expense or comfort spared, Hollywood. People don't know that. All they see is the jungle.
Oh, I see a lot more than that, and it's real. It's fun. It's interesting, but you know, in the end, I want to provide you with something that you can go, you know, I didn't think of that, or wow, you know, that looks like something I really should have. Even if I'm not preparing for the end of the world, I think I should have that particular knife because it will help me overcome obstacles I may not foresee. You know, that's what I want to leave you with in the end of, huh, that was kind of cool, and I didn't think of that.
Yeah, people like seeing stuff. I've discovered that. Well, so now I know why you're here at the Shelby Hamfest, because Fort Mill is just down the road. Mm-hmm. What have you discovered about hams that you've interacted? Is this your first, well, in sailing, you've encountered hams. You probably had talks and discussions about what they do. But as you're working toward this end of things, what led you to decide to come here, and what's been the result? What did you find out? And be honest as you were before we rolled the camera, because these guys can take it.
One thing, the reason Shelby Hamfest was opted to come out here is it was an inexpensive way to dabble our toes in an alternative market. Alternative market meaning one that's not necessarily a preparedness market. It was close so that we can actually operate on and, you know, without spending lots of money and get our feet wet with the hams. Actually being out here with the bunch, it's interesting. We knew that hams do have a preparedness mindset.
Some
of them do. And
maybe a somewhat higher percentage than the general population, but I would say probably not a really higher percentage.
We also found that through just a little bit of education, while a ham may not have thought they were a prepper, they're like, oh, well, I've actually been doing some of that stuff. And so we're getting the message out also. We're creating awareness for the magazine. We're getting the message out. It was an easy venue to do. Not sure how to take the whole, you know, ham community. I can't really make comments on that. I think it would require me to go somewhere like the Ohio show or...
So you're aware enough of ham radio to know that Dayton is the mecca in May of... And I would wager that were you to go there, you would not be the only one in your subject area exhibiting there. You'd find... You know, maybe not right down your alley, but you'd find folks at least in the same lane.
Right. And with it being the Mecca, that would probably be a very wise choice for us to have something at.
Yeah.
To have a presence at.
Because of the 24,000 people that would be there, several thousand would be interested in what you've got. That's probably a pretty good audience. What other kinds of venues do you go to?
Oh, we go to hunting and outdoor. We go to disaster preparedness venues. We really go to all sorts of venues. It's anybody that is, you know, thinking preparedness, which come to find out are more and more and more people in different industries altogether. So we travel all over. We've got several personnel that, you know, they handle trade shows and whatnot. I can't do them all. This one's close, so I decided to come out to it and see how that's all going. And it's, you know, it's fun, though.
Okay, so the ham community has, I'm not sure if you had expectations for them to meet or not, but you probably had hopes. I operate on high hopes, low expectations, and probably didn't reach your hopes anyway.
From what I understand of this particular show is this venue has gone through a different couple location changes.
Hard times.
Yeah. So we didn't have a lot of expectations coming out here. When we do venues, we go into them, you know, we're not trying to sell anything. We're not trying to do any of that. We are literally here just to produce awareness. And that's, we accomplished that here, even though it was much smaller crowds and everything that we wanted. There's still an awareness that we got out.
Yep. So, let's see. In terms of other ham venues, I'll recommend Orlando and Huntsville. They're are going to be within a day's drive of your headquarters. So those are two big ones. Shelby used to be in that category, and I very much would like to see them regain that status. A good, vibrant Hamfest, good for all of us, but they're not there right now. So,
right.
And boy, did they take a hit last night.
Oh, didn't they?
Yeah, the storm came by, and I've seen some pictures. I was leaving as the storm was coming in. My wife said, "You get your stuff packed up and get out because it's going to hit." And listening on the repeater, which is something that we can do, you know, I can hear folks from back here talking about what's going on, and you know, that's one of our cool advantages. Is they're talking torrential rain, 50 mile an hour winds, and then some folks showed me pictures of tents blowing across the parking lot. So,
yeah, it was. I was in Charlotte, and I was out to dinner with my wife, and I looked up at the sky, and I went, it looks like we're going to get a little bit of rain, but I bet Shelby's getting hammered right now. Yeah. And come to find out, they were.
Yep. And it's not always that intense, but there's always a deluge at Shelby. It doesn't rain all day, every day, but it rains for an hour, big time, sometime during the weekend. And you just, you have to be prepared.
Yes, you do.
Probably rainstorms not high on the list of prepared.
Actually, it's a lot more rain and being a pilot. You did say you were a pilot, correct?
Yeah, inactive. I learned to fly when I was a teenager and flew for a few years, but my interest in aviation remained strong.
Still,
welcome to Aviation Today.
You still know that there is downbursts, there's wind shears, there is some weather events that are instantaneous that can have lasting effects.
Yeah, but I'm thinking magazine article headline, heavy rain. What to do? Probably not.
Probably not. However, you also know that out here in the mountainous areas, when it rains, it pours.
I've heard that. And I'm not sure that's the context.
No, and when it does, they have the instantaneous flash floods, and all of a sudden you can go from sitting, doing nothing, enjoying this peaceful, great terrain to surviving. And, you know, how are you going to do it? How are you going to go from sitting on top of that nice mountain where you had, you know, lunch that was just a beautiful way to spend the weekend to now surviving and getting back to society? This is part of the preparedness idea.
You're sounding a little paranoid there, Ray.
No.
Oh, there's an article for you. Paranoia, real or imagined?
It's not paranoia. It is just general preparedness. And general preparedness is not just stockpiling things. It's knowledge. It's, you know, lighting fire without a match is a lot harder than it looks. Can you do it?
We're back to the Boy Scout thing.
I mean,
where we started.
So once again, this is your general preparedness idea. You know,
do you want to hear from people, are you already inundated with ideas?
No, we are always looking to hear from people. We want to know the ideas. Even if they don't show up in the next issue or two, it doesn't mean they're not logged and kept on file. And you never know. We may reach out to that idea person and go, hey, why don't you write us a few lines about it? And you could end up in the magazine real easily. The magazine is small enough that you can still reach, you know, the upper echelons and, you know, the editorial staff. Nobody's, you know, turning you away. You can go to our Facebook page. You can follow along. You can send emails into the website to the editor. We want to hear from everybody.
The website, again, is here, prepped and prepared.com. Might have a problem with the ampersand and the website thing. Can you put ampersands in web addresses?
No.
Okay, so you want to be ampersand, but for the website, they're forcing you into something.
Correct.
And we've got a newspaper back in Raleigh called the News Observer. and they opted to leave the ampersand and the and out. It's just newsobserver.com. So I recommend scarfing up as many URLs versions of that as you can. And maybe you already have.
We actively work on that. We own a veritable portfolio of URLs.
Yeah, yeah. And I was going to say, do it before anybody sees the show, because otherwise they're going to scarf them up and sell them back to you. That's the way we are.
Oh, yes, it is.
All right. Well, thank you very much for coming on Ham Radio Now. It's been the least hamish episode that we have done, but I think one of the more interesting, and one that I think our audience is going to appreciate. So thanks for coming on. And very good luck with the magazine. I hope it works out well.
Well, thank you very much.
So this is it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I am Gary Pierce. My guest is Ray, say your last name again.
Fosdick.
Okay. And from Prepped and Prepared magazine, television show, media empire, wherever you can go. And that's it again for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.